Thank you very much. So it's a work in progress, so please don't download anything from the web. If you are interested, please rather write to me and I'll send you some work which is a little bit more advanced. I first learn better how to use the things. Okay, right. So it's about multidimensional poverty, like half of people in this conference, I guess. Now it's a very popular theme. And this one will be a new method based on priority information about expenses. So there are many now measures of multidimensional poverty, although the monetary based poverty measure are still the one which are used in practice in many cases. And what I'm trying to do in this paper is to explore an approach which is related to basic needs. There is a very large literature, as I said. Here are a few papers. You can find scores of other ones on multidimensional poverty indices. The multidimensional poverty indices are calculated by aggregating at the individual level individual poverty or individual deprivation measures into scores and then aggregating these scores to reach a global poverty index, which is called multidimensional. This is a big progress on poverty analysis in a sense that this rise of indicators, multidimensional indicators, has mobilized much better some information which was neglected on diverse qualitative deprivation. So that's important to study these topics. Now there are issues with the multidimensional poverty indices. The dimension of welfare, the attributes, are often arbitrary, and sometimes they are not very well adapted to the countries which are used. When you try to calculate them, you find that in some countries there is almost nobody poor, although in practice, there are poor people, and there is a social policy, and there is social work to do in this country. So the choice of the welfare dimension is an issue. Some people discuss the fact that it's possible to aggregate heterogeneous indicators in the same indicators. There is also the question of using common variables, like income, rather than variables which would directly describe some welfare attributes or basic needs. The measurement of needs is a problem because there is a lot of heterogeneity in household needs, in actual data, in actual situations. And the weights which are used to aggregate these various dimensions are also often arbitrary. There is a huge quantity of papers now coming out with different ways of calculating weights to aggregate individual deprivation into an individual poverty index, which would be aggregated for multidimensional poverty. The counting approach, which has been developed by James, also is important, but it has also its own arbitrariness. So it's about trying to relax the arbitrariness of these indices by using responses from household to spending priorities. When you ask them, to what would you spend a small additional sum of money, which is a very easy question to include in a survey, you can use the answer for doing basically three things: to identify the relevant deprivation, the kind of welfare attributes that you would like to include in your analysis. You can use also this answer to identify the poor as by defining them as people who are deprived in the top priorities instead of the whole range of welfare attributes. I'll show what is a problem to use all the welfare attributes. And you can use also this priority data to aggregate for each household the various deprivation indices. So that's the idea of this paper in progress. So it has many advantages. First, you don't need to use common variables because you are going to be able to work with stated needs or stated deprivation instead of necessarily income or other variables. You can avoid the arbitrariness which arises in many stages of the construction of this poverty indices or inequality indices, whatever you want to study. And it's also somehow easier empirically to elicit deprivation by asking people about their expenditure priorities rather than having very vague and general questions. And by concentrating on the deprivation, on self-deprivation information, you can also avoid many issues with needs heterogeneity. Right. So there are, I'm not going to show any formula, there are almost none. But there are deprivation indices. They are called DI for an individual I, and this is a vector. So you have DIJ, which is the deprivation in the attribute J, suffered by individual I. And in the literature, it is dominated by two approaches of identifying the poor. The one is the intersection approach, where the poor person is the person who is poor in all the selected welfare dimension, and that leads empirically to estimates of poverty which are ridiculously small, sometimes zero. On the union approach, somebody is poor, is defined as poor when in at least one of the selected dimension, the person is deprived, and this leads to exaggerated estimate of poverty. Often you have with the messy data that we use, half of the population who is considered as poor in well-off countries. Okay, so there are ways to try to go over this question, for example, using the count in deprivation, like in James' work. Right. So what I'm working on at the moment is how to develop an axiomatics for this kind of indicators, multi-dimensional poverty indicators, and you have series of axioms that many of you are familiar with. Some of these axioms you are familiar with. You have technical axioms, continuity, normalization, scale, invariance, derivability, population invariance, etc. These are more technical axioms to help you with the mathematics than rather normative content. You have the decomposition axioms, which are sometimes replaced by Pareto axioms, which will deliver the same kind of linear formula of kernel functions. You have focus axioms, which embody, if you like, what you say when you are talking about poverty, the fact that there are poor who are poor, people who are poor and people who are non-poor. And these axioms can be more or less strong in a multidimensional setting. And you have transfer and correlation axiom, correlation between the different attributes of welfare, which tells you about somehow some subjacent utility, properties of utility. So there would be some convexity or substitutability or complementarity notion included in these axioms. And the three series of axioms, decomposition, focus and transfer and correlation axioms, are somehow, I would not say contradictory, but difficult to reconcile because they don't proceed from the same philosophy in a sense. The transfer on correlation axioms, it's more, they are more often inspired from a representation of individual utility properties. And the other axioms are building some constraint into utility-consistent representation of poverty in that case. So there are already some difficulties in reconciling these different kind of axioms. And the axioms that I'm going to add in this sitting are axioms to incorporate the information on priorities. So axioms for the specification of the welfare attributes. Today, I'm just going to say, okay, the welfare attributes, they are the one that the people mention in their answer. Selection of the top priorities for identifying the poor. I'm just going today to say, okay, let's just count the number of top priorities and see what they are. and aggregation of the deprivation to generate weight when you aggregate deprivation. And this is at the individual or at the global level. And here you see, I'll just look at simple cases. But each of these topics can be more or less technical or abstract, depending on the level of generality you want to place yourself. Right? So, I need to save time. So, identifying the poor, the first thing to understand is that you don't need to use the same dimension to identify the poor and to measure the intensity of poverty for somebody who has been identified as a poor. Okay. And that is going to have some advantages in generating some more interesting estimators. To know how many deprivation you need to use for identifying the poor, if you have data on priorities of people, you can use this data. Sometimes it's easy to see in the data, or sometimes you can do some econometrics. In this paper, I'm going to use some truncated con data models on priorities, on which it would be possible to estimate some expected number of priorities. And that would give you the kind of criterion that people use in a quant approach, where they have to choose a threshold for the number of dimensions. Okay, so it's possible to use this data associated with some axioms to identify the poor in a more varied and efficient way. It's also possible to generate non-arbitrary weights. Perhaps what I can do is to skip over all the slides, because I'm sure I won't have much time, and move. Okay, there are axioms. Let's look at simple pragmatic indicators in Seychelles. I'm going to show a few numbers for Seychelles. I tell you in advance, in Seychelles, I found that it just needed to look at two dimensions, really, to describe the poor and their shelter and food in Seychelles, the most important dimension. And poverty incidence, in that case, would be the union criterion, except that this criterion is not a priori, it's extracted from the data. I didn't know in advance that food and shelter were the important dimension before to look at the priority data in this country. So now you can do a little bit more than that. You can, if you want to build amount of poverty indicators or multidimensional poverty indicators, you can keep, you see on the first line, the formula to identify the poor with a union criterion based on these priorities, which has been considered as the top priorities by people. And then you can complete it, for example, here by multiplying by a sum of weighted deprivation indicators, where the weights can be extracted from the priority data again. So it's possible, you see, with these techniques, once you introduce this kind of information, to generate a range of indicators which would play the role that you want them to play when you want to define a multidimensional poverty. Here, for example, a simple example of weight is the proportion of people who stated that the weight for the jth attribute is the proportion of people who stated that this is their first priority. This is a simple thing. Okay, let's forget about math. And it's not ready, so I'd rather skip it. Empirical application, Seychelles, so it's technically considered as an African country, but it's in the Indian Ocean, and it's a middle-income country, which is, at the moment, moving from a planned economy to market-based economy with macro stabilization plan a few years ago, structural reforms, and the very generous system of social transfer has been and is being reformed and cut down dramatically. So there is really a social problem, and the poor are suffering a lot in this country. So it's a good idea to pay attention to them at that time. So I did a new survey, a new kind of survey in this country, which I call the living condition survey, in which the household who had been surveyed in a household budget had been resurveyed, and I was able to ask them additional question, subjective information that you find in many surveys about their subjective living standard, but also some simple question on spending priorities. Okay, thanks, Murray. So okay, there are poor people in Seychelles. I estimated the poverty monetary rate at 17%, where the poverty line is reflects the opinion of people on subsistence minima in Seychelles. So that's for monetary poverty with methods which are rather standard and well known. And there are other needs. Here are the priorities. Priorities, when you ask people, what is your first priority? We give you a little bit more money. What do you spend it on? What do we learn by looking at that? We find that food and shelter are more important, but there are other priorities, water and electricity, you see, health. And you have things which are not basic needs, you know, holiday, okay? Some people spend on holiday. If you look at others, you have a lot of people who, when they have some additional money, they are going to give it to somebody else. So it's very nice. This is the kind of data that you can get in this question. So, five significant basic needs: shelter, food, electricity, water, health, education, which I didn't know clearly, although I had done the estimation on poverty. Shelter, I didn't know that shelter was so important in the mind of people. If you use the union criterion, 42% of poor households in Seychelles, so clearly it doesn't make sense, and it's not useful for social policy. You are not going to help half of the population. So that would not work. And then you can cut down. And if you keep only the two main priorities, and I'll give some argument why to keep the two main priority dimensions, you end up only with 8% people who are poor in the country. You can do some econometrics, so it's very preliminary. I have to build my own estimator for this kind of data. But already there, the dependent variable is the number of priorities which have been stated by household. Or you can regress on various variables. This is important because you want to condition. There is no reason why the number of top priorities on these top priorities should be the same for everywhere. You could have different top priorities for rural and urban areas, for example. So conditioning, having a model to condition, is going to help you. And from this kind of model, you can look at expected number of priorities, or if you want, expected number of priorities for the monetary poor or for the rural people or for different categories. And what you find in Seychelles, it's the top line, which is about 2. Let's just do one piece of poverty analysis with this kind of method. So you see, I have not yet mobilized the very complicated indicators which are likely to come out from the axiomatic analysis. This is, at the moment, very pragmatic stuff. And we have here a table where we have it's a kind of poverty profile table. You know, you have the education of the head, and you look at the poverty estimates. So the right column is the incidence of monetary poverty, the usual one, head count index. What you find is that it is clearly decreasing with education, what you find in almost all countries. If you do this kind of table in almost all countries, the level of monetary poverty decreases with the education of the head and decreases a lot. Now, with multidimensional poverty, the two columns are two different indices of multidimensional poverty, you don't find it. You don't find it. So, why is that? It's because the multidimensional poor in Seychelles, in that sense, they are the shelter food poor. And if they are the shelter food poor, even if you have a certain amount of introduction of the other dimension of poverty, this focusing coming from the data itself is going to dominate the analysis, and they tell you that people who have low level of education, no schooling, primary education, they are less poor than people who have secondary education. Why is that? It's because in Seychelles, you have social programs which give, thanks Murray, which give free accommodation to the people who have no secondary education. So you are able to understand things that you could not see with the monetary poverty analysis. Of course, there are two different notions of poverty. None of them is right or wrong, but there is a potential to find some interesting features by using these approaches. So that's all. That's very preliminary. So the idea is to use expense priority to improve on the methodology of multidimensional poverty and to remove some arbitrary choices in the current methods. You need a special survey, but it's really not costly. And I've still to finish the estimation on the axiomatics on this paper. Thank you. So any comment, welcome.